Hi, so I thought I'd start a video blog of my fishing. It's the end of the season. It's March 14th, 2017. So what better way to do it than basically the start of the next season, which is tomorrow. Obviously the rivers are closed, but still plenty of pools to be at. And today I'm at Dudmaston, which is on the Kimber Freeliners ticket, which is probably the most amazing pool I've ever fished. It's one of those places where you're never probably going to catch an absolute monster, but it's just a magical venue to be at. And I'll turn the camera around in a minute and you can have a look at what I'm looking at now, and you'll probably agree. I mean, if you're an out and out specie hunter, then it's the sort of pool that's not for you. If you want to go and catch big carp and mud pigs and everything else, then you don't fish a place like this. You fish a place like this sheerly for the surroundings. But also, it's absolutely chocker with 4-pound tench. And if you get fed up of catching 4-pound tench, then there's something wrong with you. So I'll spin the camera around and you can have a look. So this is one of the first pegs as you walk into the lake, and this is, I suppose, what we all call the shallows, and the reeds over on the far bank. And then off up the lake you see the old boathouse. That's the field that normally has the cows in. Most people who are members know that I don't particularly get on well with cows. I suppose I've got a slight cow phobia, which is a bit weird, but hey ho. I mean, I'm here today, the last day of the fishing season. There was one other car in the car park, and I think I've got this entire estate lake to myself. Hi, so we're going to have a look at the stuff I've brought, because over the last 12 months I've decided to travel really, well, light, basically. I could probably get it a bit lighter, but I remember that as a kid I used to really enjoy, you know, a carrier bag with some fishing tackle in it, a rod, a landing net, you know, cheap steel from Argos, or when you scrounge out of your granddad's shed and you go down to the pool, you sit there all day, and, you know, it was the best fishing experience ever. And I kind of got caught up in the consumerism, I suppose, of fishing. I worked for a fishing tackle manufacturer, got given lots of free stuff, which was really nice. And then you start to believe that you need this stuff, you know, you need all the fancy kit to go out and catch fish. And if you go out and catch, you know, a 9-pound carp, and, you know, it's a rubbish day because, you know, it's all about the doubles, or it's all about the big tench and the big roach. But since I've scaled down my fishing tackle and started fishing again like I was a kid, then I've enjoyed it a hell of a lot more. So I'm just going to go through a few things that I've brought out today. I know some people like to take barrel loads of stuff and spod rods, and, you know, a lure rod, a feeder rod, a float rod, a carp rod, you know, just in case a situation arises. But today I decided to come out and feed a fish, and I've got the float rod just in case. So I've basically got two rods and a small amount of tackle, but I'll go through that now. So as I was saying, that is all my stuff for today. Like I said, it's probably a bit much, actually. I can definitely get this down a lot lighter. I got the big landing net simply because I was getting my little one out the shed and I realised that it was broke, so I've had to bring the big one, otherwise I'd have probably a net half that size for this pool. Landing net pole, one hooking mat. It's a must for Kimvert, which is a fantastic rule, and all clubs should do it. Then I've got the bag and chair, which all combines, and it just goes on your back, and it's just so easy to walk with it. You've got your hands free. Then I've got float rod, float reel, feeder rod, feeder reel. I didn't bring any bank sticks today because I knew that some of the places, or the platform, were a bit hard, so I bought the feeder arm, just It's a little bit heavier than a couple of bant sticks, but it's, you know, it's worth it because I would have never got a bant stick in here, obviously. Right. Sometimes bring a radio and some earphones because just to keep an. I like to listen to the news, so, you know, it's not essential, but it's something I like to bring. Pint of maggots, half pint of sweet corn, forceps, because they're just better for squeezing shot on and unhooking fish, and I just love forceps. I always come out with forceps. Then I have a look at the tackle box. Tackle box. This is the same tackle box I had as a kid, and some of the stuff in here is very similar. I mean, I've got 4 cage feeders, 3 maggot feeders, a plummet, some 1-ounce bombs, a couple of three method feeders, selection of hooks, selection of floats, catapult, scissors, swivels, shot, hook length. And my rig is literally an anti-tangle rig. It's a bit of a bolt rig with a safety bead at the top. So if I did get broke off, that would just go slide off the back. Though I'm using £10 mainline, just because I've got a bagging waggler, and you know, you can land £10 carp on this piece of cake, so it's on the rod already. And the hook length is 4 pounds, which is probably a little bit light, but at least I know that this is going to go before my main line. So, and I'd much rather put another hook length on than have to tackle up and feed it. Ground bait with a few maggots in it, nothing fancy, it's just half breadcrumb, half method mix from one of the tackle companies. I can't remember which one now. Just makes it go further. End of the day, bag of method mix is about £5. Bag of breadcrumb is about £1. Mix the two together, and you got twice as much ground bait for half the price. So there it is. That's my basic setup. And I'm not the strongest bloke in the world, and I can quite easily stick all this on my back and walk to Dudmaston, no problems. Hi, right, so I've moved now. I stayed in the first peg for probably about an hour. Didn't even have a tap, not even on single maggot, and a tiny size 18, so I think there's nothing moved into the shallows just yet. Probably being a bit optimistic. I mean, yes, it's nice and sunny for us humans, but I'm sure the water's damn cold under the surface. Anyway, I've come to probably everyone's favourite peg here, known as the Point. And I will show you a second just what it's like, and I think you'll agree that it's probably one of the prettiest fishing pegs, you know, you'll come across. So yeah, I've walked all the way up the lake now. I'm probably 2/3, maybe 3/4 of the way up, and that's Dudmaston Hall, which I believe goes back to about the 13th century or something. Obviously not that building. That building looks, I'd say that was maybe Jacobean, Georgian, maybe. Looks like Jacobean chimneys anyway. And then there's actually an old church over there, which you can't quite see at the moment. And you come around here to the boathouse. And then that's the other top of the pool. And I believe that across there there's a sunken dam. And this actually used to be two pools. But as the water level's risen, because I believe it's stream fed, and then the stream goes into the Severn further down that way, the water's risen over the centuries, I suppose, and then it's made the pool one, with like a false bottom over there, because I believe that you can find the dam wall quite easily, and all of a sudden it goes from about 20 foot of water to about 6 foot of water. So yeah, this is probably one of the deepest pegs on the lake. Fingers crossed I'll get a nibble. Oh, and while I'm at it, I noticed I was running out of ground bait. So, tip for you all. If you're fishing and you come across a molehill, get a couple of handfuls, mix it with your ground bait. Job's a good one. I mean, I've done that numerous times. Obviously, you don't need the grass, that can come out. But once you've mixed a bit of mole soil in with your bit of ground bait, there we go. That should keep me going for a few more hours. It hasn't cost me a penny. Right, so I'm packing up now, I think. It's been a hard day today. I haven't even had so much as a nibble. No idea why. Been in two of my favourite spots. Actually, I can see a guy in the distance setting up. Not caught anything. I might stop in one more spot on the walk back. I'm undecided yet. Part of me's got a bit bored, as we all do. When you sit around for a few hours and you watch a float not move or a feeder tip not twitch, it gets a bit, you know, you start to think, I could be at home doing something, planting some plants in the allotment or something else. Anyway, just thought I'd show you my kit, because I showed you it all spread out before, but I didn't show you all packed together, so here it is. Right, so that's my kit. I mean, a couple of rods, rucksack. What it's like all packed up anyway. I mean, that's pretty light. I can lift that bag one-handed, and I use my landing net pole as a bit of a walking stick, and that's it really. It's you just don't need to carry a lot. Well, I don't think you need to carry a lot anyway, and to be perfectly honest, that's probably more than I want to carry. But like I said, I've got like my radio and things in there just in case. But I could probably even knock 3 or 4 kilos out of that if I really wanted to, but that is manageable, so why bother? Anyway, that's the peg I'm leaving now. It's just starting to get a bit cold. I think it was about 15 degrees when I got here. It's not that now, it's probably more like 10, 11 now, maybe. The sun's still down there, so like I said, I might head down there and have one more go in the middle. Okay. Right, thought I'd speak to you while I'm walking. I've not done this before. Well, I've not done a video blog before, so everything's a bit new. This is the lake. That's the middle bit. And just around this bend here is probably one of my favourite swims, simply because it's where I caught, I think it was 15, no, 14 tench in an afternoon. Smallest one was probably about 3.5 pound, biggest one was about 4.5. But makes your arms ache anyway. And that's not even, that's poor normally, going by this lake standards. I mean, there's people I know that caught 30, you know, I think even 40 fish, you know, in 5 hours. So, and they're all nice fish. I mean, these aren't scabby, horrible, mouth ripped open, commercial kind of fish. These tend to look like they've never been caught before. So yeah, there's no cows about today, which is nice. Sometimes there's these, I suppose they're cows for the meat industry. They're all the castrated bulls, and you can walk through this field and they sometimes like to do a little bit of a fake charge, which is great for someone who doesn't really like cows. Normally a wave of the landing net and they disappear. There you go, so here's the middle bit of the lake, as you can see. It's still quiet. I think it's actually closed to the public now because it's a National Trust property, and normally there's dog walkers and people having picnics in the summer and so on and so forth, but not today. I'm sure it's closed now, so it's only members of the fishing club and I think the family that live in the house that can wander around. Obviously National Trust workers. Alright, see, the geese are in my spot now. I'm gonna stand by the water, see if I can see any bubbles. Well, I haven't decided to fish. It's just a bit windy, and like I said, my head's not really in it now, since you know what it gets like when you've sat there for a few hours and you haven't had much of a bite. You think, should I just go home? But no, it's a bit windy now. In fact, I'm probably giving myself excuses just to go home. But you can probably hear it on the microphone. But it's still nice to be out, windy or not. Just noticed that the poor old oak tree there is probably giving up the ghost. It looks dead as a doornail. All bits hanging on.